Dog is Family on Berks Community Television is underwritten by Answers Pet Food.
Welcome to our show, Dog is Family. My name is Barb Emmett, and I'll be your host and produce and guide for this next hour. I am a certified dog lover and a person who loves to do the best we can do for our dogs to enhance their mind, bodies, and spirits. There are so many stimulating topics in the world of dogs, and we all try to stay as current as we can and really stay informed about what is going on. I'm also the proprietor of Godfrey's Welcome to Dogdom, where we really look at everything that we're bringing in to bring out the best in our dogs. Really excited for this show. While we've had to all learn new technologies to do this through the Zoom technology, we can bring people in from all over the country, and we have done this before. And of course, today we're all sheltering at home, and I was very excited to put together this show for you. First up, my guest is Billy Hoekman from Answers Pet Foods. He's got a lot to share with us in the first half hour. And the next half hour, we have Andrea Hering from Crisis Response Canines. She's got a lot to tell you about all that. Certainly we have crises going on and how these dog teams can help. So let's go ahead with Billy Hoekman. He is talking to us from Philadelphia. Billy.
Well, thank you for having me. Appreciate it.
Of course, we are always excited when we can snag you to do any kind of presentation or talks with our folks. And this is a local channel, which then goes out to YouTube, where anyone anywhere can see what we're talking about. And I know you're sitting very comfortably there. You have your dog Lua nearby. Is that correct?
That is true. She's always, she's an interesting dog. She's kind of cat-like in that she kind of like loves to always be in the same room. But if you pet her too much, she'll leave. So she'll kind of like go away from you in her bed. So I just stare at her. So if I'm ever looking that way, she's looking very cute.
It's her. Yeah. That's great. I just want to read the folks a little bit about your background while you're sitting there ready for us to discuss some of these topics we have going on. Billy is the nutrition science director for Answers Pet Food. I'm going to read some of this to you. He's involved in formulation, research, product development, working with farms, and science education. Billy, you're also in charge of the executive veterinary program when you've linked up with a terrific veterinarian and executive veterinarian general specializing in diets specific to health issues. I know we rely on you for that as well when it becomes much more than what we can help with. You attend AFCO meetings, bless your heart, and you participate frequently in expert panels, which is great because you've got that connection and you're speaking around the country all over the place, from libraries to conferences to national conferences. And you're also on the board of directors of Royal Animal Health University, and you have numerous published articles. So we're very delighted to have you here. And you're also a member of the Weston Price Foundation, right?
And yes, absolutely, on the human side of things. And I will add, I'm not so much speaking around the country right now, but
no,
very happy to be doing, you know, connecting with people in this way.
And that's what we're all about here, right? So you and I had talked yesterday as we were starting to put all this together about helping people understand what is going on in pet food right now. A lot of folks became very concerned at first about sourcing and how they get the foods and how they keep their food safe. Can you speak a little bit about in terms generally, and then maybe Pennsylvania, since this is your state and Answers is right out of Fleetwood, Pennsylvania?
Yeah, I mean, it's been an interesting process for us because, you know, people just didn't know in the beginning. No one's ever been through this before. So people just didn't know what was going to happen. They didn't know, you know, how state governments and the federal government was going to react to anything. We didn't really, you know, and I can't reiterate enough that nobody really, you know, knew how to handle whatever.
No.
So, but we found out very quickly in the beginning that not only were we an essential business, and obviously continue to be an essential business, but every part of that supply chain has remained an essential business. And that goes from even during this, you know, the strictest part of the lockdowns, our suppliers were essential businesses. We are a manufacturer. We were an essential business. Our distributors were are an essential business. And then you, as a pet retail store, are also essential businesses. So it's been really nice. We did see obviously a big uptick in sales when people just didn't know, you know, if that was going to continue or whatever it might be. But it's been, you know, nice that people don't have to necessarily worry about what they're feeding their dogs and cats. And so that's one last thing, you know, that we can all sort of kind of worry about. And now that we're starting to see around the country, all, you know, people phase into reopening other things, obviously pet stores and our food production and all that is going to remain open. So it was nice to not skip a beat there.
That's very true. I know for us as retailers, we were very concerned. And I think it was a Friday, maybe 3 weeks ago, with that first essential business evaluation here. And then it became vitally essential business. So there was that phase in there where we didn't know till the next day, to be very honest.
And yeah.
Calling our representative, people were coming from the pet industry to say, look, we've got to have these products for the animals we are interested in care with. So everybody was really anxious. And then when we said, yes, we can still serve our customers with what we can serve the best that we can.
Yeah. And I think, and especially in the case of what we're doing, because we are providing animals with certain health conditions and that are on our protocols who are getting results that they just don't get with any other food. Mm-hmm. So if you're talking about an animal with, you know, liver disease, or you're talking about an animal with kidney disease, you know, they are on our protocol and we've gotten them to be able to normalize in terms of, you know, the numbers, and we've gotten them to be healthy again. And we've seen it time and time again throughout the history of our company. As soon as you take them off of that protocol, they are going to go back in, you know, they're into the red. So I know that some people might say, like, well, you know, if it's a crisis situation, you can just feed whatever, but that's just not an option for a lot of people. And also too, this is a time where both humans and for our pets that we can start to really reinforce healthy behaviors and say, hey, what are the things we can do, you know, nutrition wise to boost our immune system and our pet's immune system and to really get into some of these factors. So we feel very lucky to be able to continue to, you know, serve all the stores. And not that I can necessarily say anything about it, but we did use this time to, you know, really kind of fast track developing some new products. So I'm excited about that. So I think people will be very excited about what's going on. And the other note too is that there was some concern about some meat producers shutting down. But as of now, I mean, you never know when stuff can change. But as of now, so about 2 weeks before all of this sort of hit, the lockdowns and stuff like that, we had actually, or I'm sorry, a month or two before, we had already seen a big surge in our sales. Mm-hmm. So we were still trying to catch up. And then after that, we, you know, people started sort of panic buying. So we were trying to catch up with our inventory. The nice thing is we've been able to get a ton of raw material. We did add some employees, and we also added a shift at the plant. So barring normal manufacturing stuff that goes wrong, I mean, people don't, I guess, if you're not in manufacturing, you don't really understand that machines go down all the time, that especially when you're like us, you know, we're a small company that doesn't take on outside investors. So it's not like a lot of our stuff is refurbished machinery. We're not, you know, we can't go and spend $1 million on X, Y, and Z, but you know, we're producing more than we've ever produced. And so, you know, we expect to, you know, be very strong moving forward.
Yeah. You have some key points there that we were always reinforcing, is that these diets that our dogs customers are on need to have these foods. They need to have the supplements. They need to have the raw fish stock and the goat's milk for the biome in the belly. We can't have them going back. We can't have people thinking, go to the grocery store and pick up a bag off that shelf, because their dogs will over time be not thriving. So I really appreciate those comments, because that is the same message that we deliver as well. When you're feeding better, sliding back is not going to work. So we're very grateful that we have the products that people can stay on. And they've told us time and time again, you have to have these products for us. So that's been a blessing. And we really appreciate that. And I really appreciate that you didn't skip a beat with being able to manufacture and have your staff there and being able to produce this. How about the farmers? Talk to us about them through this. Are they are they able to just continue to do what they do and do what they need to do to create answers?
Yeah, I mean, that's one of the other things, you know, getting to the local Pennsylvania part of this is we take a lot of pride in supporting local, creating local jobs and you know, working with local farmers. I mean, we work, I believe it's with 24 goat milk farms. We work with a couple of, you know, our cow dairies. You know, we have farmers growing turkeys for us and chickens and all of this. And a lot of these people, you know, had the land to do it, but they were looking for an opportunity. And especially in the dairy industry. I mean, one of the great things about Pennsylvania is raw dairy is way more accepted here. You know, I always make people really jealous when I talk about the fact that in Philadelphia, I can go to my little corner store and there's raw milk right there on the shelf there. But the dairy industry has been taking a hit for a long time because, I mean, quite frankly, you know, we pasteurize dairy, which is terrible for it. And we feed cows the wrong thing, but we're able to support farmers that are doing the right thing. So all of our, you know, all of our farmers are producing this wonderful product. And so we're actually sort of bucking the trend where dairy is on the decline. Our dairy sales are always on the steep increase all across the country. And so we're able to take on new farmers who didn't really have another option. Good example of that would be David, our cheesemaker, who, you know, he produced 77,000 boxes of cheese for us last year. And he also is a cheesemaker for, you know, some local restaurants, and he has some stuff, you know, at the farm store there, and he makes really, in my opinion, the best cheese in the world. But, you know, that support makes it so he can be a full-time cheesemaker, you know, this extra source of income. And so we really, you know, it was our privilege to be able to drive that during this thing. So there was no slowdown in terms of our production, our farmers. We did obviously have to take steps in our own way. For instance, in a bummer, I haven't been able to go up to the plant. We were keeping that very, you know, close knit as much as sure. possible. Sure. So we, like everyone else, have had to adapt to certain, you know, I can't go to meetings, you know, and that kind of stuff. Obviously I'm looking forward to getting back into that more. But the farming community has become much stronger, and, you know, we're going to continue to see that moving into the future, because, you know, every time we release a new product or every time we grow, we have to make it and produce it. And so we're excited.
Yeah. And he mentions the cheese, folks, for those of you watching, you're thinking, is this dog cheese? Is this cat cheese? What kind of cheese is he talking about? Tell them a little bit about some of the products and how they do help with health.
Yeah, so we make 8 varieties of raw cheese. They're basically all cheese with an additive. So, you know, on our goat side, we have 5 goats. So it might be blueberry, cranberry. There's always sort of a healthy additive. And then we also make 3 varieties of raw cow cheese treats. Now, when we created these, we said we don't want to make something that's freeze-dried or dehydrated, because we are in the business of making raw food that has its innate moisture that's actually in a raw food state. So the cheese bites were born out of that. And it really is, anyone listening to this, they may say to themselves, feeding, you know, raw milk to a cat or dog seems crazy, or feeding a raw diet seems crazy. Everybody loves feeding cheese. And this is actually the healthy way to do it. Right? I think most people give their dog or cat cheese. This cheese is only warm to 98 degrees. And so it's a completely raw dairy product. So, and the really cool thing is we actually use the whey from the goat cheese to ferment our other products. So we're using that whole product. But the raw milk, you start with raw milk, which is the most complete food on earth. And you are losing some of the water soluble vitamins and some other substances when the whey comes off. But raw cheese is, by and large, aside from raw milk and probably eggs, the most complete food on the planet. And so you're basically getting everything you get in raw milk, which is everything we've ever discovered in nutrition. And so these are by far the healthiest treats on the market. And plus, I mean, dogs and cats go crazy for them. So
they sure do.
They come frozen. You just keep them in the fridge. I have a small dog, so I cut them into 4 or 5 pieces. They're still pretty big. And then I just keep them in a glass jar. And every time Lua comes inside, she goes right up to the fridge and says, I know where the treats are. And, you know, and each one of those has at least 1 billion probiotics. So you're further inoculating the gut with all that healthy bacteria.
Excellent. Yeah, I know my Charlie loves them. And yes, we have all of those products. And it's just an amazing way to look at treating your dog rather than full of carbohydrates, full of other additives, and baking something to a high temperature. So all of this is raw, folks. So if it sounds odd, he's explaining like why that's so good, right?
And you do get to support it. They are made at Likens Valley Creamery. So our corporate offices are in Fleetwood and our production facility is up in Elizabethville, Pennsylvania, which is north of Harrisburg. And David's not too far from there. And I would encourage, if you are a Pennsylvania listener right now, if you like Google search Likens Valley Creamery, he has a farm store there and it is the best cheese. And it is so much cheaper than, I mean, when we moved here from LA, we were buying raw cheese and we were paying $8 to $16 depending on, you know, $16 a pound or $8 for, you know, your 8 ounce block. David sells his for like $3.75 or something.
Oh my goodness.
And specific plug for, he makes smoked raw cheddar, which he actually smokes. He doesn't add liquid smoke to it. Mm-hmm. And in my opinion, it's the best cheese on the planet.
I remember when I took the tour like three or four years ago. Yeah. And we had the ice cream. I think it was ice cream. I can't remember. Well, we had a tour of the goats and the cows and the organic produce. And it was lovely because that's what we're all about. Transparency as much mm-hmm. as we can. Right. And that's just an awesome add to your diet, folks out there, with for your dog to add whole foods to that bowl. Everybody's on a different spectrum. Any other hints and tips for people adding whole foods that you like to recommend?
Well, you know, everyone can very easily add, you know, our additional products. So when you're talking about, regardless of what you're feeding, you know, what your budget is, all those different variables, everyone can add our fermented raw goat milk, our fermented raw cow's milk kefir, you know, some of the other things you mentioned. These are liquid products, and it's as easy as putting it in your sink when you go to bed. It'll be thawed in the morning. It stores for all of our additional products store for 30 days in the fridge. And the way you want to think about that is every dog or cat, just like human beings, needs some unprocessed raw food. I mean, it's just, try to relate that to yourself. If you only ate processed food, you'll get a certain result. And so I would highly recommend that, you know, find your local retailer. You know, a great local retailer is hosting this program right now. So find your local retailer. And even if you're picking up, you know, food from the grocery store or whatever, this is an important thing to add. And basically, here's what you're trying to do with your animal when it comes to food. There is no 100% predictor on what their health will be, right? So, but we can increase the probability that they will have a longer life. We can definitely increase that probability. We can increase the probability that they will have a happier life through having less conditions. Yes. And we've seen it throughout the 10 years of our company, and you see it every day, the changes in animals that happen. And really for me, it starts with how I like to relate it to people is, you know, when I was a teenager, there was a fast food place in my small town that was open 24 hours a day called Hardee's. And I ate there every day. That was the staple of my diet. That's where people hung out. And so eating fast food every day, when I was a teenager, that was totally fine. If I did that today, I would probably look different than I look currently. And I would be less healthy. So for me, a change usually happens in a dog at about 5, 6, 7 years old, where the owner starts to go, oh, they're starting to have hot spots and they're starting to have, you know, issues limping and sometimes they puke. And, you know, there's this long list of minor things. And for me, it really comes down to nutritional deficiencies. It's taken their body that long and it's operating less efficiently as it gets older to do that. And so you can avoid those types of things if you just go into your local store and maybe start adding goat's milk and fish stock or something like
that. Yes, and anything whole. Folks, we've talked about green juju. We've talked about all kinds of products to add superfoods to that bowl. A fresh pasture egg. We talked to our customers about that. We have two local places where they can go. Cage free doesn't mean pasture. So mm-hmm. we talk about adding a raw egg to the bowl. And all we're trying to help each other with, not only our dogs, but ourselves, is building that immunity and building that health for longer life. I don't know if you have any comments about studies done in Finland with Annika Borkman, Dr. Borkman, but, you know, looking at her statistics to add fresh food to the bowl increases their life 20%.
Yeah, and the funny thing is we're doing studies to figure out what we all sort of innately know.
Yeah.
I mean, there is no, I feel like because processed food has been prevalent for the last, let's say, 100 years, we see that as the standard. And then, okay, anything deviating from that has to prove that it's a good diet. But I don't think they met their burden of proof in the first place. I don't think that they proved that it was a good diet. And at being someone who goes to AFCO meetings, we know that in the 100-year history of, or however long it was, of processed food, all of that was created to put waste products from human industries somewhere. I mean, they literally talk about, they use the word recycling at these meetings, and they say, if we don't put it into pet food, it will go into landfills, and then it will be bad for the environment. Well, mm-hmm. my dog is not a landfill.
Mm-mm.
So the only thing, you know, what we do that's so much different is we produce food that is better than human grade, that animals should be eating. And that's a weird thing that we have to sort of, you know, that we have to prove that is a better thing. But we're happy, we do have some wonderful data when it comes to a lot of things, and we're happy to do that because we love science. But it is weird that, you know, some maybe in the traditional veterinary community or something like that are saying, well, this is the standard. Well, says what science? Comparative to what? So
mm-hmm. And some of the prescription diets that typically don't have anything medicinal necessarily in those prescription diets that are out there in the world. I don't know if you want to speak to that, but
yeah, I mean, it just goes back to the more you see the regulation in how those things are made, and, you know, the relationship between the FDA and AFCO and the way that they make laws without, you know, actually the authority to do so. You just start to see that over time, it really is just about money. Just like everything else, you know,
it is. It makes the world around.
Yeah. And that's the thing is, I think people go out of their way to think that regulators are unbiased and that they're just, I'm going to do my job and keep the public safe or pets safe or whatever it might be. But I have definitely learned over the last few years of, you know, working alongside the FDA and you know, AFCO and these organizations, people are people.
Mm-hmm.
And they definitely, you know, have agendas, and you just have to sift through that. So we have to work within that system.
Yes.
But I think we're doing a good job.
Yeah, complete. You're doing a fabulous job, and complete and balanced, you know, intuitively, it's just, we know, I think you're doing a great job, and we're thrilled to have these products for our dogs. I can't tell you. So thank you so much. And there's other companies, small companies doing the best. And we have a whole new segment too, gently cooked. And I know there's a lot of conversations about that, like just mm-hmm. a gentle cooking method, sous vide, whatever. So there are ways that people can feed better, knowing the companies, knowing, looking for transparency, understanding the passion and commitment behind these companies. And Answers is one of those. And there are other small companies doing fabulous jobs. And
yeah. Exactly.
Well, till the day, you know, everybody wants studies, like you said, and we also know in our gut too what's right. So, right?
Well, and that's the thing is, though, there are, you know, the way that people evaluate data is sort of, you know, just generally there's a lot of confirmation bias that goes on.
Yes.
So if something happens that is against what you want to be true, you say, well, show me the study.
Yes.
But you know, a great example of that was I had a conversation with someone once, and I said, they, you know, we have an 88-page health guide, which has a ton of different diets for ailments. And I said, they said, oh, how did you come up with these? And we said, well, we work with individual case studies and we notice patterns, right? And we say, okay. And the cool thing is this is now ramping up because of our new vet program, but we work right with these individual cases and we say, okay, if we introduced raw goat milk to, you know, 100 dogs that had elevated liver enzymes and those liver enzymes came down, we can make a reasonable assumption that your liver enzymes are likely to come down. And this happened to be a vet and said, hey, that's anecdotal though. And I said, yeah, you know, that is anecdotal, but let me ask you a question. If you've ever been at your practice and you've been working and you have a hard case, do you ever call your friend and ask if they've had that case and if anything's worked? And she said, yeah. And I said, well, that's anecdotal. Mm-hmm. So we all do the best we can to gather the information we have. There are new studies coming out, you know, on the raw food side of things, but you know, we're all trying to navigate this world in that way.
Yeah. And just maybe one more or two more comments about how you specifically help people when they do contact answers with some health situations. I know your guides are there for liver. I think Addison, can you name the areas now that you're really helping people help us help people to get the right diet mix?
I wish I could name them all.
I can't, because
considering that you know, me and my two bosses wrote them all. So I wish I could be like, oh, I know exactly what they are.
It's like, but, counting on your hands. Oops, I forgot one.
Yeah. Because there's quite a few now, but yes. You know, a lot of the main ones, you're talking about kidney disease, you know, yep. We have an endocrine protocol, which does things like Cushing's and hyperthyroidism in that spectrum. We even have like a senior protocol for non-asymptomatic dogs that are starting to slow down.
Okay.
If people reach out to us at info@answerspetfood.com, you can get the PDF of that. And one thing that I did was, I used to do a lot of nutrition consultations, but it turns out there's too many of you and only one of me. So
yes. It
just wasn't feasible. So I did create a worksheet on the back of each of those protocols. And what happens is, if you start at step one, which is finding out how many calories your dog needs in our feeding calculator, and I promise if you just follow the steps through, you'll get the exact amount you need to do for each protocol. And all the products are available at local stores like yours.
Hey, that's great, because unfortunately I didn't even know that that was worksheet was on the back of those things. So I better get a copy.
You need to email us and
retailer.
We'll send one right away. Absolutely.
I definitely need that to help folks. That's great to know, though. That's excellent. Yeah, and the calculator is very helpful. We direct people there all the time. Billy, are there any final notes as we all try to get through this to just say our dogs, the people who are watching this, we love our dogs heart and soul, and they're with us through this COVID. Is there anything else you just want to share before we say goodbye today?
Yeah, I think continue to support your pet's health by buying local Pennsylvania products like ours, but also continue to support your own health by buying local Pennsylvania products from farmers. This is an awesome time. I have, through this whole thing, been driving up to the farms that I shop at specifically, and been able to get a lot of my groceries from local farms. What a great habit to get into now and continue to doing into the future.
Oh, that's excellent. That's excellent. Thank you. What a wonderful thought. And that's what we're all about, like relationships, neighborhoods, support local. And I appreciate all those messages. If they have any questions, info@answerspetfood.com, correct?
Yep.
And Billy, thank you so much. I hope we have you back again at the store so people can chat in detail and go from there.
But awesome. Once we can, I would love to do that.
Stay safe, stay well, and we'll have to say goodbye.
Awesome. Thank you very much.
You're welcome. Bye-bye, folks. And we'll be back with Andrea Hering from Crisis Response Canines. Hi, everybody. Thank you for staying with us during that short break. I thank Billy Hoekman from Answers Pet Food because he's much more than representing a food, folks. His knowledge and nutrition and his background and the industry, he's an incredible resource that can give us the pulse of what's happening out there. So I hope you enjoyed that one. And now we're switching to have our second guest on, Andrea. And she's going to be Andrea Hering, and she's coming to us from New Jersey. And again, we're zooming in. Hi, Andrea.
Hi, how are you?
There she is. Hello, you lovely lady. We've been communicating through all this remote stuff. This is my first Zoom at home, and I'm glad that we could get this to happen.
Right. We're excited to be here.
Yay, it's hard. I want to give folks a little bit of your background. You had such a nice background to share. And like many of us that love dogs, we start in one way in our careers and our lives, and then we get pulled into another direction. And if we're lucky enough, we can combine that avocation and that love with the careers that we may have, or we do something totally different, like I did at 50, starting a business for dogs and celebrating them. So anyway, Andrea, you're a graduate of Philadelphia University of BS in Fashion Design. And you had many different, well, some jobs in as a buyer and working that career. And then you went into an independent insurance company, right? Which gave you time to start volunteering. Tell us a little bit about how that journey went from your career to your change in your life.
So it was funny because growing up, I always wanted a dog and my mother never let me have pets. And so she always told me, when you move out and get a house of your own, you can get a dog. And don't you know, my husband and I had our house built, and 2 weeks after moving in, I brought home my first dog, and within that first year, we had three.
So that's great.
I always had a passion for dogs, and I absolutely love them. And my second dog, Rusty, that I adopted, he came to me from Georgia. He was a rescue. He was actually hit by a car and left on the side of the road. And I was looking for a second dog. I read his profile. They said he was the sweetest dog in the world. You know, he doesn't know a stranger. And he was actually living in a vet's office while they recovered him. And then when he was ready to be transported, they were going to ship him up to New Jersey. So, and that's how I got him, actually. And I got him sight unseen. But when he came into my life, I just knew he was special. He was exactly what they described him to be. Everyone just fell in love with him. He's a very calm dog. He's sweet. He really is very intuitive. He knows when, you know, people need a little extra. And so when I got Rusty, I was actually working as a buyer. I didn't have a lot of time on my hands to do the pet therapy, but I did. You know, I didn't have kids at the time, so after work and stuff, I would do pet therapy, and I got more and more involved with that. And then as my schedule got a little busier, I was looking for a career change so I could spend more time with my dogs, because it became such a big part of my life. And so I was fortunate enough to make the transition into the industry I'm in now. I'm self-employed, and I do get to spend a lot more time with my dog, and they can come to my office if I'd like.
Yeah. And it's just interesting how important all that can become. And we hear that inner calling that says, I got to change this. So then you went from Rusty, that you know, with him as a rescue and such a special little guy that had the ability to give, and you recognized all that. How did that proceed for you? And how did you come to being the co-founder of Crisis Response Canines? Tell us that journey.
So, you know, my first dog, my first dog was Knox, and he was an agility dog, like through and through, like he was an active dog. So then when I got Rusty, I just knew he was different, you know, and I really truly feel that Rusty was brought into my life so I could share him with people and, you know, share him with individuals who need him the most. So I found pet therapy because of Rusty, and his temperament is what drove me to it. And from working with Rusty, I realized the benefit that these canines had with individuals. And unfortunately, as time went on, situations got a little more complex, more traumatic incidents were happening. And they were asking us to put our traditional therapy dogs in more unpredictable environments, because generally a therapy dog is known to go into a very predictable environment,
yes,
nursing home or a hospital. But we found, you know, and people found too, that these dogs provided such a decompression for individuals, just, you know, a sense of calm for a little bit. So they started to ask us maybe if there was a tragic event at a school or, or an untimely death somewhere or something. So that's how we transitioned into a crisis response team, because the dogs were fine, but our handlers needed more training.
Yes. I was going to say that. That's a whole different skill set. I know Charlie, yep, is a golden retriever of mine. He's a registered therapy dog. And we would visit schools and they're reading to him. It's very relaxed. It's very calm. I can imagine that the handlers really do need a whole different level of skill set to be able to go into tragic situations. That's not easy.
Absolutely. You know, and just what to say to somebody who's just experienced something that you can't even imagine. Or what not to say.
Yes.
One of the biggest things, you know, is to let the dog do the work, you know, because for us to stand there and hold the other end of the leash, you know, because dogs do not talk.
Yeah.
Judge. You know, a lot of times after these situations, a lot of counselors come in, you know, or they're asking questions or how do you feel? And people don't want, you know, they're tired of talking or, you know, and so the dogs are just a really nice outlet where if they want to hug them, they want to cry on them, they can do that. And they're not going to be judged.
No. And so you, I mean, co-founding an organization is not an easy thing to do. You had the drive to do that, to set up a 501 nonprofit organization. Tell us about that and the energy and how you saw it happening and, you know, all of it. How do you set up the structure and what do people have to show and demonstrate? Give us that.
I'm very fortunate. I have another co-founder, John Hunt, you know, that I actually met through, I therapy dog tested his dog, Gunther. And, you know, just, and everyone I met in the therapy dog world, and we all just started to see, you know, how else we could use these dogs.
Yes.
So my drive really was to provide an organization for not only the communities that we serve, but also for the therapy dog handlers that wanted to give back. You know, unfortunately right now, my dog is semi-retired. So I sometimes have been working without a dog, but I still have the passion, because even when I'm on these visits and you're able to see the smiles these dogs bring to people's faces, it's so rewarding and it makes it all worth it. But as for our structure as an organization, we do have two levels of teams. We have our comfort level, which is like our pet therapy. So we focus on our local communities. We visit our dispatch centers. Some dogs go to church, the library, the school. So we still have all that to keep our dogs working.
Okay.
And have an operational deployment team as well. And that's really the team that will deploy nationally if there is a large scale event.
Oh my goodness. And you formed this, what year?
2018.
Okay. And you had to go through like this certification process for the team, like for the dog or for the people? What
That's
does it
correct.
Require?
So all of our dogs come to us. They have to be a minimum of 1 year old. They have to hold a national therapy dog certificate from an organization. And then they, so like Alliance of Therapy Dogs or Therapy Dogs International, somewhere like that, but it has to be a national organization. Then our dogs have a AKC, the American Kennel Club, Canine Good Citizen Test.
Right.
We will do temperament testing. Our handlers do have a reference letter, you know, from their community stating that their dog and the handler is active. And so that's really what they come to us with. And then with us, we help them achieve some of our further testing. Now, some teams are comfortable and they're fine being on, they want to be on the comfort team. And then other teams do have the goal to eventually move to the operational deployment.
Wow. And have you sent your teams, your operational deployment teams? Tell us a little bit about where they've served.
Absolutely. So our team members have served since Pulse Nightclub in Florida and pretty many large scale shootings since then. Most recently, we were at in Pittsburgh, like out in, towards Pittsburgh, there was that turnpike bus accident, as well as they had a line of duty death at the same time. So we worked with the critical incident team out there. We provided the dogs. We worked with the turnpike workers, first responders, and so forth.
God bless them.
Yeah.
And right now, how do you, are you able to operate with COVID-19 and sheltering in place? Like, does this override that? Like, how do you work with that if something came up today with your operational team?
First and foremost, it's care, safety, and welfare of our teams.
Okay. You know,
we take all proper precautions. Most of our teams, we've been doing virtual pet therapy visits. You know, we sent some pizza to our dispatch team saying that we're thinking of them. I do have some teams that are working. They do have special permission to be working.
Okay.
It's all, you know, all regulations and guidelines, masks, hand cleaning the dogs are taking place.
So you're still able to serve with these teams. That's wonderful.
We are. And just maintain social distancing.
Yeah, that's great though, because I'm sure, I mean, this all keeps happening and I'm sure you've seen the increase in more critical situations for
Absolutely.
Your teams. How many teams can you speak to the growth or how many teams you might have? Comfort team?
We currently have 25 teams, which are throughout the country.
Wow.
So I have teams, a lot of us are in New Jersey, but I do have Pennsylvania. I have Virginia, Maryland. We have far out as Colorado.
Oh my goodness.
Yeah, it helps us, you know, if there is a national event or a large scale event, we don't have to fly all of our teams, you know, from the West Coast or something like that.
Yeah, so your procedures, your process is taken out and replicated out there. Yeah, that's amazing. And they're all volunteers, correct?
They're all volunteers.
Wow. And as far as paid support on this, it's probably the labors of love, I would assume, right?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Being able to bring smiles to people's faces is all that, it makes it all worth it.
You know, you had a phrasing on your webpage that was just beautiful. Now I'm trying to remember. It was like, when someone is hurting, there are things we can do. That's on the webpage.
Yeah.
And that's beautiful. I mean, it just talks about the bond and there's when someone is hurting, there are things we can do. And that's what seems to be behind this. I see all kinds of, do people have to be background checked and so forth to do all that? Are there all kinds of, okay.
Absolutely. Because we're going into school districts, you know, things. So we do all the background checks on our volunteers as well.
Okay. And how do you support this then? If it's all volunteer, are you fundraising to help build this for your
corporate?
I mean, most of the people are doing, I think, their own equipment, right? They just get whatever they need. There's no funding. How do you?
So there's no funding for us, but we do provide the organization as our volunteers as much as we can.
Okay.
So we do have corporate sponsorships, which we're always looking for corporate sponsorships.
Okay.
Individual fundraising. And that's really
that's
how
going
we operate.
On.
Yeah.
Do you have a team that does that for you guys or how does that work?
Me and two other volunteers.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Wow.
Our team is very dedicated.
Obviously.
For me, I would like to provide as much as I can to my volunteers because they dedicate so much time. We've had quite a few volunteers receive the highest level of presidential awards. They've had over 300 volunteer hours within a year.
Oh my.
It's unbelievable. What
that is a lot of hours. Yes, I was looking here. The highest American Kennel Club therapy dog titles.
That's correct. One of our dogs, Gunther, he just won the recognition this year for the American Kennel Club Therapy Dog of the Year.
Whoa, did he really? What service is that? That is incredible.
Yeah.
Did you say that's John's dog?
That is John's dog.
Oh, wow. That's amazing. Yeah, I see Presidential Service Awards, Jefferson Service Award. Folks, these dogs and these teams are doing amazing things. Special mission. Recognition from the United Methodist Women National Office. There's a lot of things going on here, Andrea, that you've accomplished in a very short time.
And we couldn't do it without our volunteers. They are so dedicated. They absolutely love their dogs, and they just want to give back to the community.
And that's where this show is all about, Dog is Family. And it's about enhancing the bond that you have with your dog, how you can reach out and do more with your dogs. And they're your dogs. They're your family, but you're out giving. And I think that that is an important message that people hear. They're not service dogs raised by someone else. They're their own dog. And what plans do you see, or what do you see as your challenges, or where do you think you're headed? You wait and you respond, correct?
Kind of, yes. But we have been really, just working with the community, even if it's just supporting them in local events and walkathons and just education. And it's cool too, because we have a whole different types of dogs. So we have Rottweilers, we have pit bulls. My next dog will hopefully be a border collie.
Busy one.
we also provide education that it's any type of dog can be a therapy dog. Any type of dog can be compassionate. And it's really cool to be able to share our love for dogs and educate the community as well. So we were invited to the American Kennel Club Meet the Breeds with our therapy dogs.
Oh, very nice.
We had a Great Dane there, and it was really cool, kind of, because they have each of the breed booths, but then they got to see some of the work that all these breeds can do.
That's awesome, everybody. It's all inclusive. It's if you feel your dog has the temperament.
That's right. Absolutely.
I have Goldens, and one was. He's a total giver. Like, you can see it. He works in the store. He was the nurturer. He wants to help people. My other one, he's all about what he wanted to do, So they all have
that's
different,
right. Opinions,
whether they're golden or not,
Yeah, exactly. Because I have a 13 and a half year old golden who's a total goofball, so he's not your typical therapy dog golden.
Right.
No.
Right.
He finds himself to be hysterical, even at 13 and a half.
That's how one of
them. Yeah, and he just fits that, that mold and that criteria perfectly.
So we'll just continue. The other thing I wanted to talk about was all your evaluator statuses and everything that you've done. I mean, Alliance of Therapy Dog Tester Observer, AKC Canine Good Citizen Evaluator, former agility instructor, former therapy dog prep instructor, canine body language instructor. I love that one. I love them all. Former basic obedience instructor. So you've certainly been an active and busy young lady.
I have. And I will say the canine body language to me is one of the most important.
Me too.
As well as we make sure our teams understand that, because our dogs are our number one priority when working. And if you cannot read that your dog is stressed or tired or needs a timeout, it's not going to be beneficial for anybody.
Isn't that the truth? As much as we want to serve and we want to give, maybe they're just not into it either that day.
Well, that's very true too.
Where they get older and we don't always pick up that maybe this isn't what they want to do right now anymore, right?
And that was probably one of the hardest decisions with Rusty, because I knew how much he used to love it, and I started to see behavior changes. And I knew I could read his body language. His time span was shorter and shorter, for how long he could visit. But I also, on the flip side, know a lot of people that they want to do the work so much that they still kind of keep pushing the dog. So you have to be your dog's advocate, and it is not easy,
That's not easy.
No. And when you have such a special dog, especially a special therapy dog, to start thinking, will I ever have another dog like this again? Or will I ever get these experiences? It's a hard decision to retire that dog. But that's why body language is so important. You're your dog's advocate.
Yeah. Oh, thank you for that message. Yeah, absolutely. That is an important one for all of us as we change in life and things change, they change.
Absolutely.
We have to see all that. Are there any other goals you're looking at? Like, with all of these things you've done personally, what's your next? Anything growth there? You're raising children, so that's
huge. Two kids, yeah.
Yeah, and getting through all of this, right?
Yes. So my next big thing is to get another crisis response dog, but in addition, an agility dog. So that's kind of the tricky part, because there's two different personalities, but I wanted in one dog, so... Yeah.
That's great. I wish you the best of luck with that.
Thank you. Thank you.
Yeah, that's very interesting. And one of our local, I know our customers comes in and is on one of your teams is Debbie Grusel with her dog Lambo.
Lambo.
We were hoping that they could have, you know, at least been on our show today. And I love to hear, and she'll send me pictures if she's serving. So that's a local connection that I know I have. I don't know if there's others in my area that are serving, but it's really neat for me to follow Lambo when he's called out.
Yeah.
So that's been fun. Hi, Debbie, if you're watching. She is. Maybe Lambo's watching. And
you know, sure he is.
Lambo's a smart little guy.
Right? Well, and he's a border collie mix.
Yes, you know? He is.
He's not your typical therapy dog sometimes when people think.
Right. Right. So that's nice for us to have that connection. And that's how we learned about you. So I appreciate Debbie.
Thank you. Well. Yeah.
And whatever we can do, even through my store, my channels, like if you have brochures or anything, I can certainly put that out so people know you're here.
Absolutely.
And how about contact information? Is there anything you want to discuss anything else? Should we do some of the contact information for you?
I was going to say, you know, follow us on Facebook, you know, Crisis Canines.
And is it Canines with the word, not a
spelled out, yes.
Yes, this is Canines on Facebook.
Yeah, so follow us on Facebook because we do post our events if we're going to be somewhere. And also what we're up to. And you could always reach us on our website, crisiscanines.org. Again, it's all spelled out.
And it was interesting for me when I was looking at all that and I was seeing the national connection with where you're serving nationally because I was thinking you were more locally based with your community. Mm-hmm. So when I saw the reach that you have, it was just amazing. And I just think it's a fabulous initiative that you've done. Here's a question. Do your dogs ever go into like courtroom traumatic case? Is that considered crisis response?
It is. So they take a special dog, you know, because they should be calm and lay at somebody's feet. They can't be nudging because some of our goldens, you know.
Yeah. Yeah.
So yes, we have had the opportunity with specific teams to do that kind of work.
Okay. So that's part of it as well. That's excellent. So I commend all of you and your team and what you've done. That's awesome for us. And if folks have any questions, reach out to Andrea.
Absolutely.
Watching. She's what a fabulous gal you are and what a wonderful program you've started here. And you did it during COVID-19. We did all this today. That's awesome.
Right. Well, we hope to bring our dogs to you one day so you can meet them. And maybe my puppy.
Maybe your puppy by then, right?
Yeah.
That would be excellent. Any final thoughts before we have to all move on with our day? Anything else you'd like to
leave? Thank you. Thank you for inviting the Crisis Canines on, and we really appreciate it.
You are so welcome. I'm glad we connected. Thank you so
much. Absolutely.
Be safe. Be well.
You too. Have a wonderful day.
Thank you. Bye, Andrea. Bye.
Dog is Family on Berks Community Television is underwritten by Answers Pet Food.